quality engineer by Sun Microsystems in Boston, and she worked on various test automation tools and was awarded a patent for the design and implementation of the stream modules. And she was also part of the team that launched the first Java browser, Hot Java. In time, Sunita sought of direct end customer engagement and joined Bridgespan, a startup that was looking to build solutions to automate end-to-end process of closing on a home. And soon Sunita moved into a management role and learned what it took to inspire and motivate a team through ups and downs. She worked her way up to the director and then VP of engineering in the span of 4 years. Following Bridgespan, Sunita co-founded a company with two of her former colleagues called Collaborato. And within a few years, Sunita took a break from there.
The break was for my baby.
And after a year, she started exploring once more. And then she was hired by eBay. Within a few years at eBay, Sunita worked away and became the director of both consumer selling and business selling tools. Under her leadership, the global teams were given clear, defined charters. She's an authentic and transparent leader and serves as a role model for team. Who is a minority in the women in technology. Others look at her for pointers and active advice, and she's a very good informal mentor. She currently lives in San Jose with her family. And this session is going to be about technology that connects the world to e-commerce. So over to you, Sunita. And
then thank you. Thank you.
eBay is sponsoring the lunch for people who are joining the Tech Connect sessions now and in the next session from 12 to 1. So please enjoy the session and even enjoy the lunch. Over to you, Sunita. I'm really glad.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that very sweet introduction. So you it's rather embarrassing, no, when people stand up and say all these lovely things about you. You think, really? Is that really me? So what I thought would be great to talk about is, we're in the middle of an e-commerce revolution, right, across the world. And eBay sort of has been in the forefront of that revolution. And what I really wanted to take an opportunity to do was to talk to you about that technology. How have we built a technology stack, right, all the levels of technology stack that allow us to deliver that experience? Now, when most people think about eBay, they don't realize that we're actually a portfolio of a number of companies. Right? It's not just one company. People have heard about the marketplaces. People have heard about PayPal. And are probably aware that, there's probably just two properties. But that's not true. There are several properties. And in this portfolio, though, what brings it all together is that we're in the business of enabling millions of people to buy and sell and to essentially pay online. Right? So if you look at this portfolio, we'll have things like classified ads, where people can just put things up for sale, and then the actual transaction happens offline. Right, so Kijiji is an example of that. Marketplace is an example of that. And these are acquisitions that we've done across the world of players that we think are doing a great job connecting buyers and sellers. Then we have properties like Pro Stores, Magento, which help small businesses get started, build their own web store, help them drive traffic to that store, so to just help them build their business. And of course, then we have StubHub and Half.com. And these are properties that are vertically defined. India is full of these new verticals. Every time I come back, I hear, did you go to Jaipur.com? And did you go here? All of these things that customize and specific types of products, right? That's exactly what Half and StubHub are about. And then, of course, you have the big properties of eBay and PayPal, right? And as I said, it's really about connecting people. So the real question is, what is our mission as a company? What is our purpose? Right. Our purpose is about connecting and creating opportunity together. If you think back on the good old days, trade was essentially how people connected all around the world. Right. The first group of people came together, and that connection between people happened through trade. So really, commerce is a common language that helps bring people together from different parts of the world. Right. Our CEO, John, always tells the story where he says, on eBay, you could have a person from Palestine sell something purchased by somebody in Israel. Think about that. People where there is so much hatred, so much struggle in the world, can actually come together just through the exchange of products and through trade. And that's the whole point of connectedness. We come together because we can create opportunity around the world. It makes the world a smaller place. It's amazing to me when I was in Ahmedabad and I ran into a seller on eBay. And the first thing that seller said to me is, my products are up on eBay, and I had somebody in Brazil buy my product. Whatever possibility would that person have had prior to eBay to have that opportunity, right? So that's what inspires us, for those of us that are in eBay, and that's when we started to think, okay, what are the kinds of technology that we can use to deliver on this promise? Before I actually get into the specifics of eBay though, as you know, and being in India, you'd clearly know that, you know, we're in the throes of a massive revolution with respect to commerce, right? And there's this real intersection of online and offline commerce. So think about it. Today, when you want to buy something, you may go to the store and then say, ah, let me just use my smartphone and see what it's available online. Can I get it cheaper someplace else, right? Or you're at home, you do all your research, and then you go out and buy something. So there's this blurring of online and offline, right? What's also happening is that your expectations as buyers are going up every day. So previously, you know, you maybe have been willing to wait a while to receive something, and now you want it now. Not only that, just like when you walk into a store, you look at the kind of attention you get, right? How do you get treated? You know, how much personalized attention you get? People expecting that on websites today. I remember now I go to a website and if I feel like it caters to mainly male products, I'm like, forget it, this site is not for me. You want it to be personalized, right? So just be like, customer expectations are changing drastically. Offline and online are really kind of like merging and coming together. And really, in the US now, we can say one out of every $5 is actually spent online. And it's true in India too. The purchasing power of people in India is growing up so much that for the segment of the population that can purchase, right, they're constantly buying online. When I landed, I went to see a cousin of mine whom I would never have imagined that she would have been online. The first thing she says to me is, oh, I bought so many products on eBay, and you know, I have these complaints. Right? This didn't arrive on time and I couldn't return this product. It was like, great feedback, but you know, before you be so critical, I'm so impressed. I'm so impressed that so many people are living their lives through sort of through engaging with the internet. It's amazing to me. So that notion of having an increasing representation of within your wallet, how much gets online, is another massive revolution that we're seeing, right? And we also talk about, you know, data, right? In fact, let me tell you, when you think about eBay, before I get to this, when you actually think about what eBay has done, we have about 128 million active users in the marketplace, right? 146 million people who have a PayPal account and actually make purchases online, right? And just in 1 year, in 2013, we did about, I want to say, close to 200 billion in just pure e-commerce volume. And how much data do we have? 200 petabytes of data. A petabyte of data is about 1,000 terabytes of data, right? This is a humongous amount of data. And when you have this kind of data, then you have a responsibility to analyze and leverage it to personalize, right? Everybody talks about big data, right? I feel we're dealing with gargantuan quantities of data. We were big data probably several years ago because of the sheer volume of commerce volume that we do. And so we can share some interesting facts, right? Every 2 seconds, somebody buys a shoe on eBay. Every 2 seconds, right? Every 2 seconds, some woman apparel is sold. Every 7 minutes, and this is my favorite one, every 7 minutes, a teacup is sold. Can you do that? A teacup is sold. I mean, when you start to get these sorts of insights, you really start to understand, you know, what are people interested in buying and selling? You know, and how do we actually start to capture this data? Right? That's the other piece of it. How do we get this data? So we track. You know, when you go into the store, the storekeeper is looking at your body language. Ah, she's going towards Chanderi or she's going towards Kanjivaram, right? But we don't have that luxury of somebody actually watching you. So we're watching behind the scenes. Okay. So we're saying, they bid on this item if it's an auction item, or they clicked on this item and they bought the item, right? Or how long did they stay on a page? What kinds of search queries did this person run? And just by watching your activity and collecting all that behavioral data and then understanding what are the kinds of things you actually bought, what did you put in your cart, right? We pull all of that information together and that's what enables us to personalize experience. And so when we talk about volumes, this is some stats, 700 terabytes of queries per month, 13 petabytes of semi-structured data. This is the volume of data that we're looking at. And on a daily basis, or actually on an hourly basis, 36 terabytes of data is what we're transferring into our data warehouse, right, that then enables us to analyze and build experiences for our buyers and sellers all over the world. And by the way, the interesting thing here is that you can't just look at data as a monolith, right? Because there are cultural differences. So they're not just gender differences, there are cultural differences. The kinds of things that people in India would be interested in buying could be very different from the kinds of things that people in Russia are interested in buying. So all of this data has to be segmented by geography, by gender, right? And then we start to sort of understand. And even within regions, what we find is that there are certain kinds of things that are bought predominantly in Middle America versus the coasts. Right. Tech products, you push something up and it'll just go really quickly in the big metropolitan areas. In the rural areas then, what you would find is that a lot of the secondhand products, like for example, you had an iPhone and then the iPhone 6 comes out, where is the iPhone 5 being sold? It's to the smaller regions because now it becomes more affordable for them. Right? So those are the ways in which you sort of power and enable commerce through data. So let's take a little bit of, let's get out of the hood. Let's just now switch gears a little bit. So we've set the stage for you on commerce and the volume of data that we use. How do we build that? What is our tech stack that actually enables us to do it? So at the base layer, there's the infrastructure and operations layer. It's what you would expect. We need power, we need data centers, we need networks, hardware, all of this sort of stuff. Think about that bottom tier as essentially the skeleton. Right? Let's take the analogy to our own human anatomy. So that's essentially the skeleton. What's on top of the skeleton is your technology platform, which is essentially all the stuff that gives you your access to your database, your logging, your monitoring capabilities, crawling, right? Remember, I was talking about all of the data that we want to get. It's not just data that we receive. We can also crawl other sites and see what people are doing on other sites and do sort of comparative analysis. So there's the crawling infrastructure. And remember, every single application shouldn't have to repeat all of these things, right? These should be at the level of the platform that can be leveraged by everybody. So that's essentially your platform tier. Right? You have an analytics platform. This is what we referred to earlier. What is Teradata? Teradata is essentially a hugely parallel processing system, right? That allows petabytes and terabytes of data to get transferred into it and complex queries to be run. That's essentially what Teradata is. What is an experimentation platform? Like I said to you earlier, we need to know how our buyers and sellers are reacting to changes that we roll out. And how do we do that? We run A/B tests. So we say we're going to take a segment of the traffic and we're going to put them into this experience. Another segment of the traffic, we're going to give them the old experience. And we're going to say, watch their behavioral data. What are they clicking? Are they spending more time on the page? Right? What are the kinds of things that you're doing? And this is how we get a pulse. All that body language that shopkeepers read when you walk into a store, we derive that intelligence by just through our A/B testing framework. So we do that. And then, of course, Hadoop. You know, everybody's talking about Hadoop today, right? Most of us have dealt with SQL databases and things like that. What is the point of Hadoop? We have enormous amounts of unstructured data, right? To put something in a database table, you're all technical people. You need to have a very clear structure on how things go. But really, a lot of the intelligence is embedded in descriptions. It's embedded in sort of blogs. It's embedded in all of this unstructured data. And that's where you talk about storing it in Hadoop so that you can engage in machine learned algorithms. I'll give you a simple example. At eBay today, a buyer comes and wants to buy something. What is the first thing after they've decided what they want to buy? What does a buyer care about? You probably care about how quickly can I get that item, right? Now, when the seller puts that up to sale, the seller is going to say, I'm willing to use these services, these shipping services, right? And the approximate costs of these services. And we, as you know, with every shipping service, they set a certain expectation on duration, right? When it'll get delivered. But really, once you know who the buyer is and where the buyer is and the buyer's location relative to the seller's location, you can be a lot smarter in terms of setting expectation, right? You can say, wait, the seller is in Bombay and I'm in Bombay, this thing could get to me in a day. Why should then, when that buyer goes to the site, we need to be smart enough to say, we can get this item for you in one day. That intelligence only we can do. That's where we use machine learned algorithms. So we take all of the data that we have of buying and selling. We also print labels, right? So we know how much it costs, so we can actually do machine learned algorithms and predict and help the seller decide how much they should charge in terms of ship cost. Similarly, for the buyer, we can predict how quickly that item will get to you. And that, what does that help? That helps the buyer, it sets the right expectation, and it helps eBay. Right? So this is how, again, you know, people say think globally, act locally. What we can start to do is connect local buyers to local sellers so that things get to you very fast. You can even pick things up locally. So that's the strength of the analytics platform. Layer on top of that, and by the way, I like to refer to the technology platform or the analytics platform as essentially the nervous system. So you have the skeleton and then you have the nervous system. Once you have these two pieces, you need those brains. And that's the commerce services, right? That's the essence of all the different elements that you would expect to see. You want to have a cart, you want to be able to pay, you want to be able to ship. All of the services that have the business logic that powers that piece. There's people in this room that power the selling services. There are people in this room that power the trust services, right, from eBay. So all of that is essentially the commerce platform, right? Let's call that the brain. And then eventually, just the services in and of themselves aren't going to help us. So what are we going to do? We have to build the experiences. And these experiences used to just be web pages, right? But now, you got your tablets, you got a mobile, people are going back and forth between devices. So we talk about generating experiences that are multi-device. And talk about customer expectation. I'm sure some of you will surf on eBay, we'll take a look at something on your tablet, and then you're ready to buy, you go to the website. We better make sure that we know exactly what you are doing here so that we give you that same experience. Or you put things in your cart, on your iPhone, you want to be able to pay on your website. So that is generating the right level of experiences, and we call that the skin. So that's essentially, you know, based on the human analogy, it gives you an idea of all of the layers. It's a high level overview of our architecture. So now let me dig a little deeper and talk about the different kinds of innovation that we do. You can imagine that when you're running an e-commerce company of the scale that we are talking about, we need huge amounts of power. Right, to power our servers. Power is a really big deal for us. Right? And John Donahoe, the CEO, said, you know, we're about creating opportunity. We're about being socially responsible. We've got to reduce our carbon footprint. The amount of power that we need as a company to power our data centers is unbelievable. So what can we do? So we actually paired up with this company called Bloom Cells, and which are essentially fuel cells that provide power through natural gas, right? And we took our biggest data center in Salt Lake City, and we said 90% of the power is going to come from these Bloom cells. And that's what we do today. 90% of the power for that Salt Lake City, that I want to say 80% of our traffic, e-commerce volume, goes through that site, right? That is powered almost entirely by natural gas. And you know what we realized is that being socially responsible also made business sense. Why? Because in actuality, our availability and our reliability of our services went up. An unexpected consequence, right? But it's fantastic for us. So not only did we try to be socially responsible, but we also ended up feeling like it made complete business sense. Then let's talk about data centers. You know, we will probably have about 100,000 fleet of servers, you know, huge volume. And then when you go into new markets, you all know, suddenly you say, oh my God, I need new hardware, right? To build out a data center is extraordinarily expensive. It's about like $350 million to build out a data center, right? But sometimes you just need more capacity and you're out of rack space. And it's not just the cost of building the data center, right? Then you have to find the real estate and you have to build up all the racks. It's like a long journey to open up a new data center. So the innovation that we've done here is actually in our Phoenix data center. We've built out what we call, you see these boxes, these containers, right? These are essentially modular data centers, okay? And it's really on the roof. It's on the roof of the Phoenix data center. And each one of these units has about, I want to say, about 2,000 servers in it. So what we can do now is to say, oh, we need additional capacity. Okay, we can purchase these. This is a fraction of the cost of a data center, right? It costs us about $18 million. Where is $18 million? Where is $350 million? Yeah? So this is our sort of a new thing that we've started to explore in getting these data centers, getting these modular data centers in, another form of innovation that helps us respond to the needs of increased capacity. Then, as we said, we're a global company. We have buyers and sellers from all over the world, right? So we need an optimal network, right? The network has to be such that our points of presence and, you know, it's very close to that of the ISP POPs, so that we can deliver things in a performant way, right? None of you are going to wait around and go get a cup of chai before the web page loads, right? Those days are over. You want your stuff really snappy, right? So multi-tenant global networks enables that. Multi-tenant global networks is nothing but, you know, when you have sort of isolated virtual networks that all share the same physical network. So if something goes wrong in one space, there's enough isolation that traffic can continue to move. Yeah. So that's the other thing is CDN, which is content delivery network. So let's talk a little bit about CDNs. Today we have all of our data centers in the US, right? And I'll talk a little bit about the global strategy there. But what is the most amount of data that you need? What do you believe it would be a chunk of the data, most amount of the data that we need to get to you? If you're going to make a buying decision, right, you need pictures and you need that description. Really, 90% of the data that we have to get out to you is that kind of static data. It's all the pictures and the description that describes what people want to do. So content delivery networks are nothing but, you know, sort of like multiple data centers that allow us to push data out to a number of different locations around the world, geographically distributed data centers, okay? So that we can cache the data there. So when you actually go, when you're coming in from whether it be Ahmedabad or the Philippines or anywhere in the world, Chennai or Bangalore, right? The core amount of data, a chunk of the data is locally cached near you somewhere and we can be performant. And this you know, Akamai is very well known as a CDN network, right? And that's the we leverage Akamai extensively for this purpose. But given that I said earlier that buyer expectations are shooting up like crazy, even that's not enough. Because, you know, still, that base request, because our servers are in the US, right, if you're making a request from Bangalore, that base request still has to hit the server and come back. So there is still latency there. Right. So given that now we have everybody has a mobile device and all of us are walking around like this as opposed to like this all the time, right? There's a tremendous amount of traffic coming in. So we are now saying, boy, we've got to move these data centers. We can't have all of our data centers stuck in the United States. We're going to have to move data centers out, right? So we are actually starting to do some sort of experimentation this year with a data center in Luxembourg, in Europe, and then systematically we'll think about a strategy on how we diversify our portfolio with respect to our data centers. Shifting gears a little bit, so you have the hardware. Now you want compute capabilities. You want to be rapidly able to get virtual machines. When I joined eBay 9 years ago, we would say we want to launch a new product. We would go to the ops team and we would say we need X number of machines. We want a new pool of machines to deliver this new experience. We'd have to remember to tell them 3 months in advance, because you know they really felt like it would take them that long to procure the equipment and set up the pool. It was a highly manual process, right? Today at eBay, if you want virtual machines provisioned, it takes 45 seconds. 45 seconds, we're able to get a pool set up and organized and automatically provisioned, right? And so it's literally capacity on demand. Now that we have that capability, and auto-scaling capabilities and self-service capabilities, you'll notice the word chargeback in there. What does that mean? That means that we made it so easy for developers to get machines, right? That at least sometimes, very often, it's hard to predict. So people will ask for more than they need. Yeah. So how do you drive discipline in a system? So what they started to do is they said, oh, you know what, Sunita? Your team asks for machines. We're going to charge you for those machines. So it's a chargeback capability. And that process of charging back is then going to make me sort of go back to my teams and say, guys, can we spec this? Because this is going from our budget. Right? So you can just see, right, as you give more, you add more flexibility, then you need to drive accountability through the system as well. So innovation comes in all forms. It comes in the form of policy, whether it be financial or compliance, or in all kinds of ways, you sort of drive discipline in the organization. And the other thing I would want to say is that while we build a lot of technology in-house, right, we don't have a not invented here phobia. We leverage, if people have technology out there that we can leverage, we're happy to leverage it. So, you know, we talked about Teradata, Hadoop, we allow for MySQL, we have a full-fledged Oracle database. A number of you are probably using Cassandra, NoSQL. We have these kinds of capabilities that we're building in-house to wherever we feel that there is a need, when the developer community feels like there is a need for something, the infrastructure team provides it. The platform team really looks at how we can leverage it. And at the same time, when I talked about that platform layer, what we try to do is whatever we provide, we try to give that platform layer, sort of make that consistent. Because again, as an organization, remember, you want consistency when it comes to monitoring, logging, experimentation. So whatever flexibility you give at the layers above, you need to make sure that that stays consistent. So this is that platform tier I was talking about, where the challenge or rather the goal of the platform engineering team is to say, I want to give maximum flexibility, whether somebody wants to use Java or C++ or Node or Python or Scala. We need to provide a platform that provides a framework so that there's a unified way in which the underlying infrastructure is leveraged. And at the same time, they have the flexibility to build their applications in the languages that they see fit. Right? Now, C++, you're probably wondering, C++, does anybody actually code in C++ anymore? Well, you know, it's extraordinarily performant, and so a lot of our search backend capabilities are implemented in C++. And then we talked about the platform services, where do we want consistency? Media. Why does media top the list? You can imagine, pictures, videos, right? We make all our buying decisions. We want bigger pictures. We want higher quality pictures. We want video. We want all kinds of interesting media. So that is a key platform player. How do we provide an infrastructure as a company to enable us to sort of enable that to scale? Tracking, experimentation, messaging, crawling, all of these are really standard sort of platform level services to power us. Right. And then lights out operation. So let's talk about that. If you have 100,000 fleet of servers, you can't have people manually manage that. So Sherlock is an internal name, but it's essentially our unified monitoring platform. What do? Code rolls out to the site, and we find that, oh, there are certain machines that aren't coming back up, and they need a reset. We do reset. We're able to do that automatically. We're able to monitor that automatically. The other thing that we do is, you know, sometimes you roll code, and you find that there's inconsistencies. Nitya knows this well, right? Some of the boxes don't have the new code. Then some of the boxes have the old code. Okay, so now we have the capability of taking those boxes that have the wrong version of the code out of traffic, right? And automatically updating it, patching it, putting the right version of the software, getting it back on the site. So those are all the capabilities that we have for lights out management. And the other aspect of it is world-class operations. I'll tell you, when I first joined eBay, it was an awe-inspiring experience when I went into this room. I felt like I was in a control tower of some sort of NASA, right? You walk into the room and you got all these huge panels across the wall, right? Giving you all this data, right? And because you want to know, well, at this time last year, you know, how is the business doing? How many bids did we have? What is this, you know, what is the 7-day average? What is the 30-day average? What is the year over year? All of this data was presented to you. At some levels, there are information overload. But each of these people in the center know exactly what they are tracking. You know, whether it be database health or network health or maybe a bug in the code that's causing certain discrepancies. More recently, what we've done here in terms of our innovation here is what we call real-time deviation detection. Because what we realized is, yeah, we have a ton of data, but really, what's the most important thing? The most important thing is to know if something that usually, if bids are supposed to go at a particular rate and there is a deviation from what you expect, then that's what we should flash up. Not the fact that the bids are going exactly per plan, but the fact that there is a problem, so that it helps the team, the operations team, debug the issue. So that's some of the changes we've made in the ops center to drive efficiency there. And then search. Search is, again, a big deal. I mean, in essence, you know, if you really think about any commerce platform and you talk about connecting people, what is needed at the core of that is a search engine, right? So over the years, we've done a lot of work and a lot of innovation in terms of our search capability that we internally call Cassini, using a lot of machine learned ranking, trying to solve relevance issues. The thing about the eBay inventory is that it's extraordinarily diverse. And we have, you know, while we have 70 to 80% of the inventory is new, we have also a lot of inventory that's refurbished and used, right? So how do you leverage all of that large volume of data that you have and build a search engine that is sort of performant and relevant and solve for these sorts of things? So this is another key area of investment that we've made sort of in the last 5 years. We've completely changed our search engine, and a lot of work is happening internally to drive innovation there, including full text search. There was a time in eBay where you would type in a search string, and if that search keyword that you typed into search for wasn't in the title, we wouldn't pull up that item. The kind of behavior that it drove with sellers then would say, oh my God, anything that I think my buyers are going to search for, I got to cram into that title, because that's really what's being indexed, right? Because we, in the old system, we didn't have a way of indexing and storing and searching large volumes of data. But now we have that capability. And so you can do a full text search. So now you can search for things, and even if they've called it out in the description, we will find it, and that inventory will show up for the buyer. And then, of course, what does that give us? Beautiful experiences. Yes, this is the US site. I'm sure the eBay India site also has a beautiful experience as well. And but it, you know, you go to the site, and you know, you're able to generate these kinds of experiences, whether it be on the web or on the mobile devices, whether it be on the homepage or on our deals platform. And I know deals are a really big thing here as well, with your Snap deals and your Flipkart and all kinds of interesting deals all over. So we have our version of deals as well. And it just enables us to curate. Another key theme that we're realizing that's sort of really emerging is this notion of curation of inventory, right? Because what we're saying is, you know, you can go in and you can search, but if we can find interesting things that work well together, it's almost like, you know, when you go in to a store, and if the store owner is really smart and the people who work there, they'll not just show you the dupatta, but then they'll bring other things to show you, saying, oh, you can contrast it. And then if they have jewelry in the store, say, oh, why don't you match it? And they sort of add all of these things. Curation gives you the ability to create an outfit, right? So we have people who now come in, and we have this thing called the designer collective, where they will mix and match different pieces of inventory for you. So if we just go back a couple of pages, this is actually an ad for blazers and jewelry. But we put it together to sort of people get an idea that, oh, you could get the blazer and that piece of jewelry. It may be from the same seller, it may be from different sellers, but curation gives us the ability to tell a story and to help people imagine. It's sort of our, in some ways, it's our answer to the mannequin, that when you walk into a store and you see a mannequin all dressed up and coordinated, you're like, oh, I love that entire outfit, right? So that's the vision for, that's essentially the vision for this. And so we've talked about all of the different layers, right? Right from like the skeleton to the nervous system to the brain to the skin, and you're probably wondering, okay, that's great, but whatever happened to the heart and soul of eBay, right? I'm sure you're wondering that, and I would say that is our customers. Eventually we can build all kinds of exciting things and get very excited about our technology and very excited about how things scale, but if you don't satisfy that core need of your customers, of your buyers and sellers, we haven't achieved anything. So that is the heart and soul of eBay. And you know, when John talks about the mission of the company, John Donnell, the CEO, talks about what eBay means to him and what eBay means to the community, constantly talks about how we create opportunity and we drive change in the world. And he's, you know, his challenge back to us, he said, you know, what does it take? What does it do? What are the cultural elements, you know? You can talk about all of the technology, but what are the cultural elements that enable us to win? And he always says it's about creativity and it's about discipline. And we know that. You need creativity and you need discipline. What do you need? You need a purpose. Because eventually for all of us, we want meaning out of what we're doing, right? Even when you write that code, you want to know somebody, it's actually going to get used. The products that you build, when you know customers are using it, it's a whole new level of joy. And you know you're making a difference in the world. So it's really about the purpose. And it's about the willingness to compete. Because there's so many players out there, right? And so it takes a combination of both. It's about facing the brutal facts when things aren't going well. You know, you could be leading in the market. You could have other players that come in and are disrupting you. We have to understand what's holding us back, right? So it's about facing the brutal facts. It's about relentless commitment. Just staying committed to achieve the goals that you want to achieve. And you know, this applies for a business, and as it applies for us as individuals in the way that we lead our lives too, right? And last but not least, it's about personal humility, really. And the will, the sheer will that you want to make a difference in the world, right? So that's what pulls it all together. So that's essentially it for me. I just wanted to give you a taste. I just feel like it's wonderful every time I come back to India to see the amount of change and the amount of growth at so many different levels and in so many different dimensions. And I just have to say, being at this conference has been just, people have been thanking me for coming all the way from the US, and I just have to thank you, because I could not have imagined in my wildest dreams to be able to walk into a place and have so many young women technologists. Whether you're doing product, quality, writing code, whatever your charter is, right, you're all transforming the world. Technology is one of those ways that's hugely disruptive. It enables us, you can look at technology as something that dehumanizes the world, where it creates a separation, or you can look at technology as something that's truly empowering and creates opportunity for people in the world, right? And I my heart is in that latter, which is that what is that meaning, what is that purpose, and what is that transformation? And I just feel like when I came in and I saw the sheer ocean of women that were in there, that I was surrounded by, it just made me really optimistic about our ability to transform this world. It's sort of like a peaceful, engaging, and diverse place. And now I open it up to any questions.
And platform that you have been talking, we all use e-commerce, and in India it has grown up to 254% compared to 2012. We are 254% more women are using e-commerce and doing online shopping. I hope all of you will agree this. So women are getting more and more used to this. So
absolutely.
You're going to be having a more challenge, because predicting women's next move is going to be very, very difficult. So your machine algorithms has to be more optimized. Thank you so much, Sunita.
Pleasure is mine.
Over to you guys for the questions. Please make use of...
Sure. We have two questions. Go ahead and then we'll come back to you.
If you're loud enough, what are the top three KPIs that you track
other than revenue? So we have the notion of NPS, right? So what is the, which is essentially the net promoter scores for our customers. And we are really trying to get a pulse on how many promoters do we have? How many people would say, this is a great place, I'm going to tell my friends about it, I'm going to have more people come? How many people have had negative experiences? And therefore, they would sort of fall in the category of not a promoter, but a detractor. And that's what we track to actually get a pulse on how our customers are doing. So yes, there is the key KPI of GMV, gross merchandising value, and how we're doing towards the bottom line. And then there's the pulse on the customer. And you know what? We also have the notion of the employee pulse, which is also equally important, because we feel like if we really want to make a change in the lives of our customers, we have to be equally sensitive to the lives of our employees.
It was more. It was very popular because of the bidding, the auction yes. business model, I would
yes.
say. But seeing your presentation, and we are also consumers of eBay. What sets eBay apart from competitors like Amazon?
It's a great question. So first, let me say, very often when you start, when your company starts on a certain paradigm, like we started in the auction space, right? You develop a reputation, and as you know, it's hard to change. But the truth is the data tells a very different story. And every time I open up the press and it says the auction site, I feel like saying, oh my God, you guys haven't gotten the data right, right? We are, and they also assume that we're predominantly used. Actually, we are predominantly new and we are predominantly fixed price. So I think the marketing piece of this is still catching up, okay? To answer your second question in terms of how we differentiate ourselves with our competitors, the fundamental thing is that we're a marketplace. This goes, we simply orchestrate, right? We allow our buyers and sellers to come. We don't house inventory. A lot of our competitors, they actually have warehouses. They are holding the inventory, right? We are providing a capability. So really the vision that Pierre Omidyar had for the company was creating a level playing field, right? Was providing something where that feedback could come from within the community. The community could say, this is a great seller, or this is a great product, and other people could see that. And if you think about that feedback system, we're seeing it on Uber, we're seeing it on Lyft, right? People are counting on other people. I mean, social media signals are very effective in sort of driving popularity or calling bullshit when things aren't going very well, right? So that's essentially the key thing for us, that we do not compete. Right. And we try to enable merchants of all sizes, right? So the small merchant, the large merchant. In fact, even if you take a look at the types of sellers we have on eBay, right? A large number of sellers are not just the big companies, but small people who really want to make a living. They lost their job, or they became disabled, and then they say, I need a way to support my family. There's actually a contingent of women who feel very strongly that they want to stay home and they want to homeschool their kids. They don't send them to the public school system. It's a sort of a phenomenon that I've noticed only in the United States. They want to homeschool, but they also want to support their family. So they start their businesses on eBay. Right. So that's essentially the.
Any other questions?
question. The analysts, the market analysts and the writers have been talking about this e-commerce because of the competition across different people like Amazon, Flipkart, Snapdeal, and whatever comes. So there is a prediction that in the future, we'll not have more players and probably we may have one or two. What do you see from your perspective? That isn't healthy for the consumers because we will be left with very less choices. We have to just go and look at these monopolized providers.
Yes.
So how do you think is the competition heading to? And now we have many, many, many small websites coming up and commerce, and they are doing very focused selling.
Like absolutely.
Only very few who just in India, especially. You have somebody from Gujarat just taking care of certain types of garments and clothing selling and surat and things like that. How do you see this competition and transition?
Honestly, I feel like if history is any indication, right, nothing is long term. You know, there may be a time where it goes to a couple of different things, but any kind of monopoly has been disrupted. And at the core of that disruption has been technology. So I have a lot of faith that this pattern will continue. You know, there could be a time where there'll be a lot of consolidation, and you don't just see it in technology, you see it in banking, right? You see it in all of the big companies. There's consolidation and there's disruption. And then people sort of companies branch off, new companies come in. I would never have actually, for example, Lyft is a very interesting idea, right, or Uber. Who would have thought there would be disruption in that level, in sort of like the cab space, right? You couldn't have imagined it in your wildest dreams. And I also think, by the way, that for each of us, those customized experiences, I like the fact that there is a website that I can go to that specializes in certain types of things, but I can trust that. They know enough about it. You know, they've curated it. There's a sort of like quality standards. So I think that there will be certain things where you'd want to go to a more generalized marketplace for. There'll be certain things that'll be much more specialized. And as much as we talk about the commerce revolution, really, I mean, I don't think that we've even scratched the surface yet of the amount of offline that happens that can actually go online. And as we think about that blurring, right? One of the phenomena that we're seeing, for example, is a lot of the mom and pop stores, you know, the corners, they are looking to get their inventory online. They're also looking to get foot traffic in. So one of the things that we did recently in the UK is Argos is like this big chain, okay? So within I'm not sure if it's like a 5 kilometer radius or a 5 mile radius or whatever, that everybody has an Argos. So we provided a facility for all of the sellers to be able to ship their product to an Argos, and the buyer can say, I'll just pick it up at an Argos. Why is that an advantage to that Argos store? Because you go there, you pick up something, it's foot traffic, right? So I actually think that we tend to very quickly draw conclusions and get to the sort of scarcity mentality of, oh my God, it's only going to be two, and then, you know, I don't think that'll ever happen, you know. And I think we have enough examples in history where I'm very confident. That's a great question. That's an excellent question. So this is the beauty of those machine learning algorithms with search, right? Because one of the key things that they take in as an input into showing inventory when people put in a search string is, you know, are these new listings and are these new sellers that we haven't seen before? And that becomes one of the features that we start to showcase, right? Because otherwise the website becomes very boring and very redundant, right? It's the same set of sellers selling the same types of products. So how do you get visibility? And then as they show that new inventory for a new seller and a search ranks that higher and people click at it, that's a signal. Oh, people really like this. Okay, so you feed that signal back in again, right? So that's how we allow for new sellers. And, you know, today at least, I sell stuff on eBay myself. You know, my son seems to be growing rapidly, and every other year I seem to be buying a pair of soccer shoes. And these soccer shoes, probably, they're actually very good, even though they've been used for just about under a year. Put it up for eBay, I get traffic to my listing. And I'm just an individual seller, it's not even a business, you know. I'm just using that sort of a recycling. So that is a great, that is the beauty of the search algorithm. I think that's the secret sauce.
And value proposition was brought in by your previous
So I must say that Meg Mittman and I overlapped at very short time. But this is what I would say. I would say that, you know, every leader is, every person, actually forget every leader, every single one of you in the room have your strengths and weaknesses. And if you think about when Meg came in, she came in to execute on a vision that Pierre had, right? So Pierre Omidyar had a vision, right? And the vision was to provide a platform, provide a way that small and big sellers could come together and he could drive that connection. He could sort of enable commerce and, you know, and enable it globally. You can have a vision, but you need to bring in a leader who can actually execute that vision, who can sort of say, okay, now, what are all of the things that need to be in place to make that happen? And he brought Meg in. And Meg came in to actually help, was the person who actually helped build the original vision of what was eBay and take that to a particular place. And then when she left, John came in. And I think that that's, you know, what I have witnessed through my career is that at different times in the journey of a company, different types of leaders come in. And it's probably at that time that that is the type of leader that the company needs to take that company to that next level. Right? Many times you'll see them startups, right? A startup, there are leaders who are very good at starting companies. And then they have that startup approach, they can think about creative ideas and they get it to a certain point. And then you'll see that there's a leadership change. Because now you need to bring in a different type of leader to scale the company. So I feel like that's how I see the role that Meg played moving the company forward. Great question. This is true. I work at the Whitman campus. So, great point.
One last question. Here.
I would like to know more about the marketplace of India and how it
impacts the market. So, you mean the eBay India marketplace? So, you know, eBay India marketplace, I must say anecdotally, I don't have enough information, so I apologize. But what I will say to you is this. We have had actually very good traction. It's based in Mumbai, and every single time that I come back, I seem to find that they've done more and more interesting things across the spectrum. So, for example, we have a technology team right here in Bangalore that is dedicated to taking the core platform that we have, right, and customizing it for the India market. So, for example, we have a payment solution called PaisaPay, right? Why? Because in India, people like an escrow system. You want to be able to pay, and then you want to be able to make sure that once, you know, you don't want that money to have to go to the seller until you've actually received the goods, and we're happy. So we manage the marketplace from that perspective, right? Similarly, we've been thinking about, you know, this notion of cash on delivery is really big in India, right? Somebody delivers something for you, and then you give cash. So we're doing that in the marketplace. So every year that I sort of track what we're doing from a platform perspective, there's a lot of innovation happening to service the India market. And yes, you know, competition is good. We have a lot of competitive players that have come in. But I also feel like, you know, what you would find is that because we have a long history of being able to scale, some of the problems that we've had recently on some of our other sites here, where the sites have just gone down because they haven't been able to handle that traffic, right, is something that we have the experience to handle. And so, so in that sense, that's really good. And then we also have a guarantee program to protect the sellers. So I'm very, very optimistic. I'm here, you can keep talking.
You can actually talk to Sunita over the lunch because she's going to be here and this is responsible. Please go ahead. Back to the Indian market, I mean, when you start talking about other Indian languages, so that it can attract more people and buyers for them.
That's a very good question, and it's definitely been discussed extensively. I'm not sure exactly what the plans are for that, though. But I actually think that we as a platform have localization and translation capabilities. Okay, so we're in an extraordinary number of sites, and we launched a Portuguese site, and then we launched a site in Spanish and in Russian. You know, so we have all of the core capabilities from a technology perspective to drive translation. I think the business team is making a decision on when we roll this out into multiple languages in India. So it's more a business decision and not a technology decision. So search will factor that in as well. So if, for example, if you go to a French site, right? That same, it could be, somebody could have actually listed that inventory in English, but they could type in the French equivalent, and through our translation services and things like that, we're able to support that as well. Pleasure is mine. Thank you for listening.